She'll be speaking on clinical features and surgical outcomes of pediatric rhegmatogenous retinal detachment.
Good morning, everyone. I'll be speaking on clinical features and surgical outcomes of pediatric rhegmatogenous RD in about 70 eyes. So, rhegmatogenous RD is a sight-threatening condition. It is rarer in pediatric population as compared to adults. It differs from the adults because it usually presents with a longer duration, chronic nature, absence of PVD, and there can be PVR changes. So the common predisposing factors noted are trauma, myopia, congenital abnormalities, and previous intraocular surgery. And lower anatomical success rate is found in pediatric RD surgery. So we did a retrospective study at a tertiary eye care hospital in North India of about 70 eyes of 67 patients who were less than 14 years of age, who underwent surgical intervention from a period of about 2 years, from December 16 to December 18. So we recorded the demographic details, the visual acuity and refractive status wherever possible, etiology of Reg-RD and type of surgical approach. We also grouped our patients into 5 different groups. The first group had patients who had undergone an ocular trauma. The second group included patients with congenital abnormalities. Third group had patients with myopia per se alone without any other abnormality. Fourth group included patients with idiopathic, and fifth group had previous intraocular surgery. So we either did a scleral buckling or a pars plana vitrectomy with silicone oil with or without lensectomy as and when needed. And these surgeries were performed at the same hospital by 3 different surgeons. We included patients who had at least a minimum follow-up of 6 months post-operatively. So initial reattachment of the retina was defined when it was a complete retinal reattachment following the initial surgery, either with buckle or vitrectomy. Anatomical success was defined as complete retinal attachment with or without tamponade at the last follow-up. And functional visual acuity success was defined as visual acuity more than 60 at the final follow-up. So the mean age was 9.6 years. The mean follow-up was 10 months. It ranged from 6 months to about 60 months, that is 5 years. Males were more commonly found, that is about 72%, and females were 28%. So we found the trauma was the most common cause found in our study at about 34%, followed by congenital abnormalities, that was 27%, followed by myopia at 17%, idiopathic at 13%, and previous intraocular surgery at 9%. So in the trauma subgroup, the male to female ratio was 20:4, the males were higher. And in the second subgroup, that is the congenital abnormality, the most common abnormality found was RC coloboma type 1. In about 56% of patients. One patient also presented with Marfan syndrome. And 3 patients who had bilateral RD, out of those 2 patients had RD associated with RC coloboma type 1, and 1 patient had high myopia bilaterally. In the myopic groups, high myopia was found in all the 12 eyes, that is more than minus 6 diopters. And in the previous surgery group, cataract surgery was more commonly found, that is about 4 out of 6 eyes. So other eye findings were noted in 36 eyes. They were lattice degeneration with or without retina holes, RC coloboma, then narrow funnel or close funnel RD, and one patient also had an attached retina status post RD surgery in the other eye. So retinal reattachment rate after the primary procedure was 85%, that's 60 eyes. 10 eyes had a recurrent RD. In those 10 eyes, we did re-vitrectomy in 7 eyes, and 1 patient underwent buccal revision. 2 patients did not come for any further follow-up. So we did lensectomy, vitrectomy with silicone oil in 56% patients. 28% underwent vitrectomy with silicone oil without lensectomy, and 16% underwent scleral buckling. So our retinal reattachment rate at the last follow-up was 97%, out of which 84% had an attached retina with or without silicone oil, and 13% has an attached retina after scleral buckling. Preoperatively, the visual acuity was more than 6/60 in only 2 eyes, which improved in 26 eyes, that is 37% post-operatively. And the rest 44 eyes, the visual acuity ranged from perception of light to finger countings at 3 meters. So ocular trauma is a very common cause for pediatric RD. And in trauma group, male predominance is usually found because they are more likely to get injured by a ball or a bat. Then congenital abnormalities is also a very common cause. And the factors which make these RDs complex is abnormal vitreous liquefaction, stronger posterior vitreoretinal adhesion, which lead to difficulty in PVD induction. So our primary procedure was pars plana vitrectomy, which was done in 84% of eyes because there were more of PVR changes in the patients and cataractous lens changes, which lead to hazy media, plus they were undetected breaks. So to conclude, ocular trauma and congenital abnormalities, they are mostly the most common causes for pediatric RD. But surgical procedures like SB or vitrectomy, they can achieve retinal reattachment if a timely diagnosis and intervention is done. It was a retrospective study, that is one of my limitation. And the strengths is that we included various etiologies of the RD and relatively large number of patients with a long-term follow-up. Thank you.
With your studies, you have taken too many etiologies. So comparatively, if you have a congenital abnormality, the success rate is pretty low. And if you have a trauma case, success percent is almost 100. So how do you quantify between different disease pathology, which RD will behave better with what surgery? We cannot define with this paper.
Yeah, that is true, sir. It was just the overall inclusion of all the etiologies which come with the children who come with RD. Like, what are the etiologies that they come with, whether it is trauma or it is congenital or it is myopia. So we wanted to look at that. And in that, we found the trauma was the most common cause, followed by other causes.
Other thing I would like to point out is that I think we should talk about reattachment and permanent attachment after oil removal. So you should also have told us what happens after oil removal, because many of the colobomas we know tend to detach after the day you remove the oil.
Yeah, so like 34% they had attached retina after oil removal, but 31% with the oil.
And the complexity of the retinal detachment also, you know, makes us choose whether we want to go for scleral buckling or vitrectomy.
Yes,
and
sir.
That is a very varied thing.
Yes, sir.
So
definitely.
That means, thank you.
Thank you.